Thank you. Very welcome. My name is Christoff Pienaar. I'm sure you know that already. Thank you for joining us. Thanks for our valued clients, my partners, colleagues, and thank you for agreeing to all of you for being part of this panel. I won't spend too much time on introductions as we've done it there. But I just want to make a few introductory remarks. You know, like the word FinTech is a buzzword like cloud and, you know, and the like. And what we are, you know, talking about and exploring and advising on, et cetera, is the way in which financial services are delivered, in the way it's being transformed, and in the way it's being made accessible to more and more people. And, you know, some of the panel members are going to talk about this, you know, like the scalability challenges that fintech businesses and so on face. But we will also concentrate on, you know, let's call it the other side. So not the tech provider, but the, let's call it the user or the distributor of it, the banks, the insurers, the telcos, et cetera, that, you know, also are involved in this value chain. And I don't know if you remember the film Meet the Parents, where Robert De Niro was explaining to Adam Sandler the circle of trust, and then said, "Greg, you are here." Now, that's very much how our current national payment system regulation is structured. You know, if you look on the Reserve Bank website, and you know, pretty much in every single article that's written about payment systems, you'll see that circle of trust. And you know, the further you know in the middle, you know, you have your banks, and right at the outskirts of the circle, you have your third party payment processors, and you have your operators and tech providers, etc., etc. So that's a good way of looking at it. And from a regulatory perspective, you obviously, I don't know if you've seen Silicon Valley Bank. The UK leg has been acquired by HSBC. Obviously, the UK learned, I was practicing there at the time, 2008 financial crisis, learned a hard lesson, and Gordon Brown and Alistair Darling at the time came up with a very robust bank rescue model and a deposit insurance kind of arrangement. So they knew what to do under these circumstances, but obviously in other jurisdictions it will work differently. I also want to say something about embedded finance, which is essentially the integration of technology, connectivity, regulatory license holders, the banks, the insurers, etc., to make that accessible, let's say, to the masses or to the consumer. One of the challenges I've certainly seen in South Africa is that, you know, we don't have such a big market, you know, in financial services. And obviously there's a big drive to reach as many people as possible. But fintech businesses, scalability is key to success. And, you know, pretty much every really successful fintech business I've come across has scaled beyond our borders. They've either gone into the US, gone into Europe, went into the rest of Africa, etc. Because, you know, like MasterCard don't want to process one card transaction a day. They want to process 5 billion card transactions a day, because that's the commercial model mostly followed in this space. We are also going to talk about black economic empowerment. Safiyya is going to talk about that, where there is a bit of a disparity between the codes applicable to financial services versus the technology sector. And that does create some arbitrage, and we're also going to say very little about crypto, and then very little about grey listing, because we don't really want too many people to know about it, you know, outside of the country anyway. And then Berné is going to talk about, he is at Ozow, you know, his experience for, you know, actually working at the coal face of payment processing of FinTech. And Dawid over there will talk about, you know, kind of some of the regulatory aspects, and also, you know, recent changes to FICA legislation. You know, the future of, you know, open banking, the future of banking, etc. I will also deal with some of the questions. We have not prepared a speech. This is absolutely a panel discussion, and please fire away. Can I start? Lindsay, Entersekt has been a client of mine for 12 years, and I'm very proud of them. And it just shows you, if you use the right lawyers, you'll survive. anyway, I will take absolutely no credit for their success. What I've noticed, and I think what I find, you know, like, quite amazing actually, is the way how you manage to do four funding rounds and you know, and then deployed that capital in such a responsible way that like organic growth took place over a period of 12 years. And the reason I'm asking that is a lot of fintech businesses, you'll see these kind of spikes. So they raise funds, they hire 40 people, then they retrench 30, and then, you know, it kind of goes like that. Where your trajectory was a slow growth, maybe you can make a few comments about that.
Sure, Christoff. So scaling in the fintech space obviously relies a lot on external funding. And it's the key word that you mentioned there was responsible. So being responsible with your spend, where it's very easy to get a chunk of money into the bank account and it's tempting to hire a lot of people to facilitate that growth. But the important thing is the balance between hiring for growth and not hiring too early. So it's almost like a just-in-time hiring process. But then a large part of our strategy has been not necessarily hiring in new regions when you're scaling internationally. So, for example, our core market is in South Africa, but our major growth market is in the US. So instead of rushing into the US and hiring a lot of staff there, we've used a partnership model. So it's working through partnerships to get access to markets, to the networks within the regions, as well as local knowledge, such as regulatory knowledge. So leveraging off their experience. And we have a number of different partnership models. So whether it's a simple reseller model or integrating into someone's technology, for example, digital banking platforms, we will integrate into their platform so that their host of banking customers have access to our platform without us having to access each of those banks individually. And then a major partnership that we have is actually with MasterCard, and that gives us exposure to regions such as the rest of Africa, where we don't necessarily have our own presence in terms of staff or offices, but MasterCard has massive reach. And so we can access their customers via MasterCard with our partnership. Another MasterCard partnership is with their new data offering, which is all risk-based. So that's, we're in the authentication space. So that's securing your banking channels. So that's your banking apps when you're making purchases online. We're securing those channels for you. And the MasterCard New Data platform uses risk-based metrics to help us identify where there's a risk. So partnerships has been a huge part of that strategy. And then once we find our foothold, as we're doing in the US, we start to hire more staff while we're there and finding our feet and becoming more entrenched. And of course, the beauty of this approach is that we've got such fantastic software development talent in South Africa that we can maintain that RAND-based expense in South Africa with top talent and expand internationally through partnerships and then organically find our own way into the market with our own staff.
One, let's call it a risk area, which the partnership model works very successfully in a variety of like financial technology businesses. One of the risk areas is that you might end up contracting with a MasterCard, for example, but they might decide not to actually embed your technology into their product. And from a revenue recognition perspective, that creates some challenges sometimes. And you know, the stories you can tell investors, but you know that can be managed. Something I've seen on a number of occasions, because you know they sign, let's call it like a master product license or some OEM, original equipment manufacturing type arrangement, but then their lead time to market with your technology affects your revenue recognition. So you know, that's just a commercial comment. Any questions from the audience so far? Safiyya, a lot of fintech businesses in South Africa struggle to raise sufficient capital within our borders, and they end up going for the big amounts from US, let's say, private equity, VC, Silicon Valley funds and so on. And then you end up with a situation where your South African company is majority foreign owned, and that brings certain transformation issues to the table, because from the customer side, for example, if one looks at any master services agreement used by a bank or a big corporate, there's a clause in there that says, you are currently a level three, and you will remain a level three or improve, over a period of time. And that's absolutely the right thing to do. But the funding issue, because if a fintech business goes to South African funders, they'll be offered 20 million rand. If they go to a US fund, the US fund would put in $30 million. That creates a problem. Can you say a few things about that?
Sure. Thanks, Christoph, and good morning to everyone. I suppose I'd like to start off by just pivoting what you put to me as a question and saying perhaps we can look at the problem as a possible solution. And that would be my opening gambit to your question. And I'd like to take one step back and say, obviously from a BE perspective, and you touched on it in your introductory remarks, there is no sector code that recognizes fintech. We've got a sector code that recognizes financial services and covers and regulates financial services from a BE perspective. And then we've got a sector code that recognizes and applies to companies operating in the ICT sector. The interesting thing to note there is, for example, if you fall within the financial sector code as a, as an operating entity, a financial services company, for example, to get maximum points for black ownership, you need to reach, you need to have black ownership of 25% plus one vote. On the ICT sector code, on the other hand, it's 30%. So that's an interesting thing to bear in mind. The next question obviously is, well, how do we know where do we fit into? And the answer to that is, well, each sector code basically says if you, in the ICT sector code, if the majority of your revenue is derived from technology-related operations, then you fall within the sector code. On the financial services side, it's a similar type of principle that applies. Noting that, obviously, to the extent that the type of financial institution that you're referring to requires, say, for example, banking license, insurance license, any other type of license in the financial services area, you're likely to fall within that sector code. But these type of things need to be considered. And then I probably want to say, Christoph, that in relation to how, you know, what's, how do we use this as a challenge to build? Noting that in many instances, what it requires is some innovative thinking. For example, in relation to a restructuring of, say, this FinTech company, in relation to, for example, how do we make it fit for purpose so that we can achieve BEE in substance, to meet the requirements that are applicable to that company. I just want to make one other note as well, and that is that Christoph, you mentioned that this might be a requirement that comes from customers. Absolutely. You'll find, for example, banks, insurance companies, and so forth would be looking for maximum B scores from their suppliers. But what is also definitely on the cards is that, in fact, it should have been on the cards a long time ago, I would argue, because of the BEE Act, that regulated entities, so to the extent that you are a fintech company operating in the regulated space requiring a license, the BEE Act requires that BEE requirements are incorporated into that license. And with the coming of the COFI bill, which might well apply to some of the fintech companies to the extent that they are regulated, I think we should be expecting those type of BEE requirements to be incorporated into new licenses, amended licenses, those type of things.
Currently, just from a payments perspective, you know, obviously, the third-party payment processing space is driven by the sponsoring bank. So there are no requirement on the actual payment processor, and a system operator, there it's only looking at, you know, whether you are PCI DSS compliant and whether your system can integrate with the national payment system. Yeah. So there's also not a requirement there, but in both instances one can say that a license is required.
Yes.
And you know, I know that currently the Reserve Bank is re-looking at, and PASA are re-looking at the National Payment Systems Act, and I also hope that some of those requirements will filter through.
Yeah.
A comment on you know, the coming with innovative solutions.
Yes.
And you see it more in, you know, less so in, let's call it, you know, like your pure financial technology businesses, you know, it's more in your, let's call it IT services. So they are also being acquired by foreign listed entities. You know, think of Dimension Data, Adapt IT, They all have, you know, NTT sits at the top, and you have, you know, the Constellation Software Incorporated, you know, and Villiers sitting behind Adapt IT and so on. What they do is they follow a reseller model where they actually have an empowered company that is given substance and have a customer interface. So you have that ownership, but enough of the, let's call it the day-to-day services, you know, the sale of software, the actual provision of first, second, third line support services and all of those kind of things and are then contracted to that entity. And that's been working quite well. And obviously from a skills development perspective, it is also great, you know, yes. Because, you know, you kind of, you know, like you widening the circle.
Yes.
Any question? Yes, please.
They do attach a BE level to a license. What do you anticipate that level to be?
I would say it would be at least a level 4. That would be regarded as acceptable, because that's where 100% recognition would be given. But Christoph, I wonder if I could just take this opportunity just to add also, I'm sorry, not directly answering your question, but to say on the innovative part of things, there are, for example, just to your point, there are very specific requirements in, say, the ICT sector code. In fact, also on the financial services sector code that applies to multinationals that can be taken into account, and also for purpose of structuring should be taken into account for purpose of achieving optimal.
Are those equity equivalent? Is it
equity equivalent? Yes, as a possibility, and you know there are specific requirements, but. For example, we've just been advising a client that's just been bought out by a UK entity operating in the technology space. So that entity suddenly becomes now, so it's a South African-based technology company that now becomes 100% owned by a UK company operating in the technology space. It's now regarded as a multinational company because of the definitions that apply. And they were looking at different ways of structuring. There's a need for the South African company to continue to have a certain B level and black ownership in particular, because that's the requirements from their customers. And so what the structure that's currently on the cards that actually has been approved by the shareholders and the verification agents is that an employee share trust for the South African employees, the majority of whom are black people, takes up shareholding in the multinational, which is not equivalent to 26% or 30% at the multinational level. It's probably, if my memory serves me, it's something like 3% at the international level, which equates to more than 30% at the South African entity level because of calculation methodologies and so forth that apply. So those type of things shouldn't be discounted, and it works really well from a multinational perspective as well, because it means at a South African level, they're not giving up any shareholder voting rights and so forth, but what they are departing with are the economic benefits that the code seeks to ensure ease is sold to or held by black people as defined. That's not to say that we shouldn't be looking at voting rights. We absolutely have to, but that's all part of the structuring. So I'm just using that as an example of innovative structuring that can be applied in these type of scenarios to achieve both getting optimal funding, but also black ownership. It's an example of. I just want to say one more thing. I'm sorry, and then I will stop. I read, just because I tried to read up before this the panel discussion today, the MasterCard report on on the scaling up of fintech companies and how effective fintech companies in sub-Saharan Africa has been in relation to job creation. And there's a staggering percentage of 894% year-on-year growth in relation to job creation that was referenced in that report. I think that's important because from a South African perspective, one of the challenges we are dealing with is unemployment, and unemployment of black youth in particular. Again, I think what we have not utilized sufficiently from a fintech perspective, financial services, as well as technology, is that there is this amazing credit that is given to companies looking to be measured under the BEE scorecard for the employment of black, unemployed black youth for a period of 1 year. There are certain requirements to be met, but if you do meet that, it means that you can suddenly potentially move up two levels on the scorecard. From level five, suddenly you're at a level three. If what you are doing is meeting the requirements, it's referred to as the Yes Youth Program. You would have seen or heard about it, but it's in the codes, and I don't think we look at it sufficiently and we leverage on that sufficiently.
I want to add something to that, and I've certainly learned something now. I act a lot on the investor side of these transactions. So this, let's say, the UK company buying or whoever is coming in, and the transaction is usually so kind of, let's call it, capital focused that, you know, you get a term sheet and you start implementing this transaction. Where what Safiyya is talking about now is what then happens is you implement the transaction, you have closing, you have all these things, and a year, and then obviously the scorecard is valid for a year, and then a year later they come and say, oh, what do we do about BEE? How do we solve that? Where if these kind of conversations were happening at term sheet stage, you know, you could have structured, you know, or made tweaks to the structure. So I've definitely learned something there. And I'll now turn to Dawid and to Berné, but so there's been a lot of media reports and articles and so on that says that, you know, if they talk about open banking and they talk about, you know, more kind of, let's call it, convergence and cooperation in the fintech space, the payment space, and that, you know, payment, the National Payment Systems Act is going to essentially be, let's call it, relaxed to allow more participants. Is very far from the truth. The stricter regulations are coming, but not exclusionary regulations. So just to put it in context, ATPPP, a third-party payment processor, as an example, can momentarily hold money because they're on the acquiring side of the transaction and their customer is the merchant and the merchant needs to be settled. So momentarily it goes through a bank account held in the name of the TPPP, obviously with the sponsoring bank's supervision, okay, and it's held at the sponsoring bank. And a lot of TPPPs are saying, well, why can't we, for example, repatriate funds? Because what is also in 2024, I know Visa, MasterCard's been given a dispensation, but there's going to be local processing, local switching requirements. So transactions that's taking place in South Africa will have to be switched in South Africa. Okay, so to the card associations, and now now the opportunity that a lot of fintech businesses are seeing is, okay, but Amazon and I'm talking about the retailer Amazon, not Amazon Web Services. They don't have a lot of us buy from them in South Africa, but they don't have a corporate presence in South Africa. They don't have a bank account in South Africa. So now it says, okay, if we as a third party payment processor can essentially receive all of those funds and then remit that to Amazon, you know, for all the stuff that South Africans has bought, you know, that's a great opportunity. Well, first of all, there are exchange control regulations that stands in your way, you know, to repatriate those funds. But typically, TPPPs are only allowed to repatriate funds if their sponsoring bank allows them to, and that is subject to the sponsoring bank's own internal limits for their FinServ reporting and their balance of payment requirements and so on. So that is going to continue to be the case, and the main reason for that is to protect the integrity and the stability of the South African financial infrastructure, financial system, you know, and our banking system. You know, to give an example, if a bank or if the chances, it's not impossible, but you know, all licensed banks have capital adequacy requirements and liquidity requirements, and they have to keep a certain amount at the Reserve Bank in cash. So chances of not settling on a transaction is minimal. Where, you know, a TPPP that just has a normal kind of business bank account, you know, if something happens to that money and that kind of settlement process can't take place, you essentially have this infection-like effect where the entire system is compromised as a consequence of that. I just want to ask Dawid. So, you know, and not focusing on payments specifically. But, you know, like the widening of the FICA net, the whole kind of move to you know, create more collaboration in your financial services sector. If you could make a few comments about, you know, some expected changes and recent changes on that front.
Yeah, certainly. Thanks, Christoff. I think... to start off with, I think what we've seen over the past few years is certainly the South African financial services regulators moving away from this view where traditionally they would stand on the sidelines and they would monitor and survey what's happening in the fintech industry to understand it and to get their heads around it. I think we're seeing the regulators now more actively entering this market, and they're entering it through very specific regulations. So I would say the first trend that I've seen over the past few years is the regulators moving away from standing outside of the arena. They are now very much in the arena, and I think they very much see themselves as the circus master of this arena. I would then also say that regulation up to now and going forward has been and will very much be influenced by the collaborative approach that the South African regulators have followed, specifically in the way they've organized themselves in the intergovernmental FinTech working group. And a lot of the regulations that we have seen and that I believe we will see in the future will emanate and has emanated from position papers produced by the IFWG. A few examples of that, and this was also remarked on in the recent budget, is the amendments to the Financial Advisory and Intermediary Services Act, where crypto assets have been scoped into that legislation. And so going forward, crypto assets will be regarded as financial products and therefore subject to the same requirements imposed on entities and persons who provide financial services in relation to those assets. We have also very recently seen FICA being amended also again to scope into the ambit of FICA crypto asset and crypto asset service providers. We've also seen the regulators in some instances putting their foot down quite harshly on crypto, and I mentioned crypto now because that has been a focus of regulatory intervention. For obvious reasons, we've seen last year some stress in that industry, and there's a perception that it needs to be better regulated, specifically to combat money laundering and the like, financial crime. But what I was referring to, where we've seen the regulators taking very much a foot-down approach, is we've seen amendments to Regulation 28 of the Pension Funds Act, where the regulators have said they do not believe it as appropriate for pension funds to invest in crypto assets, rightly or wrongly. But that's an instance of the regulators taking a firm view and not standing outside of this industry and now very much actively regulating it. What we also see coming out of this, I think, is the approach of our regulators will be, at least for the time being, to use existing legislation and existing regulatory frameworks to exercise their regulatory powers. That may well change in the future when we will see the entry into effect of the Conduct of Financial Institutions Bill, or Act as it will be, which I think opens up the scope for an entirely new form of regulation, it being a new act, but we await to see what will happen there. And so I think if I were to summarize regulatory trends up to now and how we can see the regulators behaving in the future, I would summarize it as we will see a more active regulator. We will see a regulator that regulates collaboratively across different regulators, and we will see a regulator in most instances using existing regulatory frameworks to exercise their regulatory powers.
That very much you know, accords with, you know, like changes in the like payment space. You know, they are not in South Africa currently, but and I can't remember now. I saw an article yesterday that external crypto exchanges are being like, they are talks about that being regulated in country. So, you know, like even if you buy crypto assets from South Africa on an exchange that might be in the US, that US exchange might be then made subject to South African regulations. But you know, and it's all to combat financial crime and money laundering and the like. I think the good news is, you know, and like, active involvement by a regulator has usually proven quite successful in the United Kingdom. So typically you have two types of approaches to financial regulation. You have an open system and you have a closed system. And the main difference is that the open system says it's permitted, but we will then regulate the unintended consequences of this. Where the closed system saying we prohibit it until we understand it, and then we will regulate for it. You know, different countries take different approaches. But I know, for example, in the UK and a lot of Western European countries, the regulators are very active, and it has definitely had a positive impact on the fintech industry as a whole, including, you know, obviously, the banks who wants to take the products to market. Just this morning there was an article, Capitec reached 20 million customers. Time Bank signed up 6.1 million customers. And the challenge that I would think the likes of Capitec has is that you know, a lot of their customers are in rural areas, and we need technology and innovative technology to provide banking services, you know, in the same way as a branch in Sandton can provide, you know, to people in rural South Africa, and this is also where your telcos are playing a very important role. The Facebook cable named Simba, that's been laid, from the east coast of the US to Africa. Number of entry points in Africa and South Africa is in Oosterfontein. So my internet should approve shortly. But anyway, essentially all the South African telcos signed up to some of those fiber pairs and so on. And it is to make data faster, more accessible, and off the back of that, your financial technology can follow, and you can have someone in a very remote place doing exactly the same what we can do, going to Sandton City. Berné, life in a fintech. You obviously at the coalface. And maybe let's start with the, let's call it regulatory or environmental, and I'm talking about the regulatory environmental frustrations experienced by a fintech company.
Thanks, thanks, Christoph. You've given me the graveyard shift where everything I'm going to say, no. I mean, they've all said already.
So. I'm going to do another run-through, don't worry.
Also just brought up trauma in me when you said Ozowfontein, because when I went there last time, I was attacked by an ostrich. regulatory challenges, I mean, just touching on what David said, we have a regulator who's really trying to get involved in the business and isn't just sitting back. And I think on your circle of trust example, which is Ben Stiller, not Adam Sandler.
Oh, sorry.
They're trying to make the circle of trust a lot bigger and not just having the market incumbent. So they're allowing the likes of Ozow to participate in the industry. The regulators are openly speaking on how they encourage things like open banking, so where we can actively collaborate with the banks. You might have seen earlier this week, banks have released PayShop for the first cohort banks to come in. So that ties in with your point on Capitec, for example, and rural areas where people don't have access to banks. So with, or branches at least, with PayShop, the intention will be that it'll link your bank account with your cell phone number and you can send and receive payments with your cell phone number. So the fact that our regulators are getting really involved in these kinds of initiatives, working with like the market incumbents and fintechs in the space to grow the market where we need it to go for South Africans to improve digital inclusion, financial inclusion, is quite exciting. Our regulations have been getting developed for quite a while where there is a gap. We're finalizing things like the curfew bill and the like to come in. At the moment, a lot of what we're doing, particularly in the fintech space, it's not yet regulated. So I know in the beginning you said don't talk crypto, but like crypto is busy getting regulated. Things like open banking are going to get regulated soon. And I think as much as there's still some scope for the regulations to grow, the fact that we're actively able to work with the regulators is quite exciting.
Thank you. Yes.
Are we expected to follow what's coming from the US and the UK or Europe from a South African point of view?
Being a common law jurisdiction and a lot of our financial services legislation, it's getting less so now, but like definitely initially, comes from the United Kingdom. They do, one would have said they followed a very conservative approach, and then they had Treasury buying 98% of Lloyd's TSB to bail them out. I think we will very much follow from a regulatory perspective, the kind of UK model, and the good news is that the UK actually operate an open regulatory system instead of a closed one. So I do think that a leaf will be taken out of that book. Yeah. Over there. Thanks.
Thank you. I just like to follow on the issue of the crypto market exchanges. Now, from a regulation point of view, you can see slowly that being regulated. If you can look at the regulation specifically regarding cryptocurrencies, that's why the pension funds have come back to say, no, we don't want the pension fund to invest in cryptocurrencies. When it comes to the exchanges that are slowly building up, through the payment system, where do you envisage to be? Either housed within the banking system, or they're going to be on their own as exchanges for the cryptocurrencies?
That's a very good question. I think hopefully we will get a better view on where the regulators will finally go with that when COFI enters into effect and they start flexing their muscles under that act. For me, it's a good question because it is difficult to situate crypto within, but you put it in a financial markets context. So are you going to now regulate crypto exchanges under the Financial Markets Act in the same way that you would regulate the JSE or any of the other new exchanges that are out there? Or are you going to regulate it more from a conduct perspective? Are you going to regulate it as a service offering under what we now know as the FASE Act? My sense is, and I've got nothing to base this on, as I say, we will need to see where COFI takes us. My sense is that it's going to be more of a conduct regulation. And in saying that, I'm not saying that there won't be any prudential regulation of exchanges, because of course there must be. But I see it more as a conduct-focused regulation rather than a financial markets perspective. But that's my view. I guess we would need to wait and see what the regulators ultimately decide to do once COFI enters into effect. But COFI will very much, I think, take forward that distinction between conduct, financial markets, and so on.
Thanks. Just on the concept of crypto, especially from a fintech perspective for Ozow, how do we see the developing regulatory landscape impacting crypto as a payment mechanism? And if we do start accepting crypto more widely, what sort of implications are there on the volatility of the underlying cryptos, and how would there be hedges against that? Or sort of a layman. So, I mean, on the side, I do cryptocurrency arbitrage myself, so I see the volatility. And also, how does this impact exchange control regulations going forward for crypto? Because, I mean, obviously the single discretionary allowances and the foreign investment allowances aren't sufficient for crypto users, especially compared to that of sending Forex offshore.
Yeah, thanks. I guess it really just depends where the regulators go on whether they're going to allow crypto to be treated as a currency or not, or if they're just going to allow it to be an investment instrument. So I think at the moment, things like transferring crypto to a friend in another exchange that, let's say, is in another country may not fall foul of exchange control regulations, but it is something that they're actively looking at. So I'm sure they know that could be a remedy that they need to regulate how the funds can be moved like that. Because obviously with crypto, a big concern that lots of entities have is on things like AML. So they need to make sure they can have a proper record on exactly where the funds are going. How we would treat it on our side, for example, it becomes very risky with the fluctuations that I think both the consumers and the merchants, if the specific merchant would want to get involved in accepting crypto as a payment mechanism, where the risk would lie if there are fluctuations. And would the merchant, for example, want to accept crypto, or is the intention that, for example, they would rather want it at some stage to be converted back into the currency? So I think we need to be guided by what the regulators will allow us to do. And then we'll obviously need to make it as easy for consumers and businesses alike to just plug into it. Hope that answers your question.
A bit more of an operational question. Thank you. A bit more of an operational question. Fintechs, I think, well, most of us are quite exciting because we read about them in the tech newspapers. They're always subject to sort of extra or more M&A activity or more capital raising. And that's nice to read about with your morning coffee. But with that goes, I imagine, a hyper-focus or extra scrutiny on sort of being ready for capital raising or M&A activity. So maybe a question both for those sitting in-house, how sort of much is this on your radar, being ready for capital raising or M&A activity? And then the flip side of that coin, for those sitting as external counsel, how do you go on that journey? And it's not just when there's spikes in activity, on an ongoing basis to make sure that your clients are ready for that, you know, heads of terms from an external investor in the US or the UK, so that there isn't a last-minute scramble for your regulation, your operational, your contracting database, all that stuff to get, you know, scramble over a weekend to get all ready. So it'd be interesting to hear the two different perspectives on that.
Lindsay, I think you do the first part.
Sure.
And because, you know, you do come from a corporate finance background and you know, have been involved in a number of fundraising. So I think, yeah.
Thanks, Christoph. Yeah, thanks for the question. What we find is that we're almost on a permanent roadshow. So it's almost always being ready for approaches, as well as looking for opportunities. So operationally, we're always ready for the pitch. and you know, being in the fintech space, as Christoph said, is a buzzword. So we are under scrutiny. There are people looking at us all the time. So we are always ready to look out for, to respond to those opportunities, but also constantly maintaining or building and maintaining relationships with potential funders. So our first few rounds of funding were South African-based. Our most recent funding round was a US Silicon Valley-based venture capitalist. And you know, it's as we're scaling, we need to start looking wider at opportunities for capital raising. So, as Christoph said, you know, you can look locally and get 10, 20 million rand, look internationally and get $30 million. And so the scope is huge to raise large amounts of money in international markets. So we need to be aware that even if we have grown organically, as Christoph said, we are comfortable and we can continue our growth path organically. But if you really want to make that growth exponential, then you've got to make sure that you're constantly building those relationships with potential funders offshore.
From a external counsel perspective, so you know, if one acts for the investor, you simply just say, you want my money, you do this list of things, and it's quite straightforward. If you're sitting on the other side, you know, one can start with, let's say, basic housekeeping, as in having an up-to-date share register. Have the necessary resolutions in place when you issue shares. You know, kind of like have like basic governance things, because that makes investors nervous. Okay, and it also creates so management might be extremely reliable, but it creates the impression that what kind of shop were you running here prior to, you know, wanting money. Okay. And it also creates a lot of frustration between external advisor and client, because the client will say, Christoph, is all these things necessary? Okay, like, do we have to externalize our intellectual property? Do we have to go through all this exchange control, audited valuations, all of these things? And it builds a lot of frustration, because in many instances, it's that fintech's first ever fundraising. And the people involved are not what I call deal fit or deal fatigued. Okay? And you know, so I would certainly say, from an external, so if you're on the investee side, make sure you get the basics right. Unfortunately, one of the requirements for many funds, which doesn't, you know, if one looks at it from a South African perspective, is not great. But a lot of foreign funds want to know that your international intellectual property or the international component sits offshore. For two reasons. One is they don't want the crown jewels to sit in South Africa because we are not necessarily viewed in that positive light by, you know, by Wall Street or by, the Canary Wharf. So what often happens is that when it happens too late, there's a huge capital gains tax implication for the business. So I would say prior to actually going on to this fundraising, let's call it roadshow or journey, have a conversation with your advisors first, that they can just have a quick look at your affairs and say, well, because we know what the investor is going to ask for, more or less. And to get deal ready, because it will save you a lot of frustration, it will save you a lot of fees, it will save you a lot of gray hairs by getting that right. Just from a kind of common sense perspective, a lot of technology in the financial sector space, we're really talking about software here. And, look at it as a handful of colored crayons. And what you essentially do is you take all the crayons except for the green one, and you take it offshore and you leave the green one, because I'm a avid Springbok supporter, you leave it in South Africa, and all the rest goes offshore. So it's like a bundle of rights, obviously software is protected by copyright, and it can be split, like I've just explained. Do it early on, just because of capital gains tax, initially, I'm not an auditor, but there are 13 valuation methods accepted by the Reserve Bank for valuing IP. And in an early stage, the only one, because, like post-revenue, one can look at revenue streams as a potential valuation, but prior to that, the only thing you can do is expensed or capitalized development cost. That is really the only thing you can look at, and that's the value. So if you do move the IP at that stage, the value will come out relatively low. Okay, but once you are up and running and your South African business is pumping, and this is now worth 100 million, then, you know, what 18.6% or whatever, more or less, is going to be a CGT hit by moving that IP across. Plus, there must be an inflow of money into South Africa for the approval. So how are you going to get the cash there? Okay. So the way that is often solved is, as part of the investment transaction, we make it a condition precedent. So money comes in abroad into, like these classic mirror structures that historically was there, put in place for, breaking the prohibition on loop structures. So often it's done as part of that. So the investment money comes in, and some of that is then used to flow, to actually pay for this IP. But just be careful, when you get to that stage, your IP might be so valuable that the CGT will be prohibitive. Does that? But does it sound familiar?
Good morning. Just to signal, the other green team are might be taking the Grand Slam this weekend. But anyway, that's another story. In my mind, fintech is strongly associated with cybercrime. How does, and obviously the massive increase as well, lately of numerous attacks. What's the view from South Africa?
Respond to that from a regulatory perspective. I think that is very much exercising the attention of the South African regulators. And I wouldn't say their first foray into actively entering this market from a regulator. It wasn't necessarily the first one, but it was certainly probably their hardest hitting intervention. And so many of the most recent regulatory interventions into this industry has been coming from the angle of we need to do something about abuses of this industry, particularly from a cybercrime perspective. I may have spoken in haste, and I may have confused cybercrime with anti-money laundering, because that's what I'm thinking about. So money laundering has been a huge focus from a regulatory perspective. Cybercrime is also important, and I think we're probably going to see a lot more of that from a regulatory perspective. But perhaps some of the industry participants, the people who are at the coalface, as Christopher said, want to remark on cybercrime, how it's influencing, or hopefully not influencing, but how it's making your life difficult and keeping you awake at night.
So if it makes you feel better, it does keep me up at night sometimes. It's always a constant thing to just keep in your mind. So I think a lot of fintechs, particularly the space that Lindsay and I work in, you'd work on having really strict tech compliance processes in place. So getting things like PCI DSS compliant, ISO compliant and the like will help build your own internal processes. And when you go through your audits to get that level of compliance, you go through extensive checks on exactly where gaps could be and where they can't be. The regulations are still catching up on how they're exactly going to manage cybercrime and cybersecurity. But from a fintech perspective, I mean, security and our products are our main assets. So I think as soon as you're seen as a company that's not secure, both consumers and businesses won't want to do anything with you. So from a general commercial perspective, it's so crucial to us to keep on top of that.
From an operational perspective, we're so aware of this that, you know, we have teams within the business who are focused on this all the time. So not just waiting for the moment when you've got the audit, but permanently being aware of having the right processes and procedures in place so that you're constantly de-risking the business. And then there are practical things as well, like lots of staff training, making sure that everybody's aware of what the risks are, simple things like email attacks. And it's the awareness within your staff complement, and also making sure that your customers are aware of what you've got in place to ensure that your company is secure, and so their data is secure as well.
One thing I just want to add to that is, so in the banking and the insurance industries, or banks and insurers, they actually have prudential requirements prudential standards that they have to comply with. And obviously financial or cyber crime and so on is part of falls into both technology risk as well as operational risk. And what I've seen a lot of big corporates do is they impose on, and well, they obviously have to in the banking insurance industry, is to run, penetration testing, to do security evaluations on, because the risk, whether we talk about, data loss risk or financial crime or whatever else, the weak spot is always the third party you pass your data on, because you don't necessarily have full control over it. So the moment there's a service provider, etc., that comes into that, so that is where your risk. So as part of an operational risk policy or a cybercrime risk policy or whatever you want to call it, is to make sure that it's not just a policy. You know, it means nothing to say in a contract that I can perform penetration testing on a quarterly basis, but I never do it. Because I don't want to pay whoever, you know, like I want to save costs, so let's skip it this time. It's to actually do those things, because the framework is there, the thinking is there, and often those mechanisms are not used. When we draft these agreements, we put, there's like a whole list of security requirements that banks and insurers and so on are commonly using. And these provisions about security testing and penetration testing and so on. But I don't do it, but I bet, you know, like my bottom dollar, that if I walk in there and say, when last did you do the penetration testing, that you can do quarterly. ask John. So the framework is there, the will is there, the contractual frameworks are there. I would just say make sure, and you know, like it's a IT risk or a compliance function, but it's to make sure that you use what is ever at your disposal to reduce your crime risk. Yeah.
Thank you. Good morning. So my question is from an investor's perspective. So, I mean, we saw that there was obviously a fintech boom that started in 2020, 2021, driven by COVID-19. And what we saw was a lot of investments into the space. And then obviously towards, I think, the beginning of 2022, mid-2022, there was issues when it came to valuations. So I just wanted to get your perspective in terms of obviously, that issue was because a lot of the investors that came in early did not see the returns that they were expecting, because the companies were actually not profitable at all. So, and right now, what I'm seeing in the market, what we're seeing in the market is that when we approach investors with clients who are in the fintech space, they are very cautious. They move cautiously in terms of how they want to, invest in the business. What is your view in terms of how you see that going forward in terms of valuations in the fintech space?
I will again work with Lindsay on this. I'll give you my view. So we spoke a lot about scalability and the funding that's required to scale. Now, if we start right at the top from, like, if you look at a funder, okay, there is a investment mandate that is given to that fund, or there's an investment committee that sits at the bank, they've got a certain mandate. And let's say only 25% of the available capital in those funds can be deployed in, let's say, at risk or as risk capital. Okay? The rest, you know, pension funds don't want to invest in fintechs. They want to invest in solid dividend returns and so on. And so you first of all have a fund mandate issue. The second one is that there's a lot of education, I think, required in the South African, let's call it VC space. For fintech or technology companies, especially if it's a product company, and I'll just briefly explain the difference. So in technology, and these are just my own kind of distinctions that I often draw, but you have a product company and you have a revenue company. Now, an Entersekt is a product company. They own valuable intellectual property that, deployed in the right way, can boom, and you can, you know, make a lot of money by doing that. A revenue company is someone like, let's say, a Dimension Data or one of the IT server BCX or so on, what their value lies in that they have 40 contracts that has got a duration of 3 years. And what they do is they supply services. So if you buy that company, you can recognize that revenue and you can immediately have an increase in your EBITDA and, you know, you can kind of like drive your share price up that way. A product company, you have to be a lot more patient because a product company have to first of all, perfect their technology. They have to adapt their technology to market demands. And then they must scale. Okay? So you very much have, you know, depending on, you know, which, in the, like whether you go for the revenue or whether you go for the capital growth ultimately, I think the philosophy is slightly different. But a product company at its early stages is exceptionally difficult to value. A revenue company, on the other hand, is quite easy to you because you just apply a multiple. but over to the accountants.
Thanks, Christoph. Yes, I mean, all good points. I think the risk appetite of the investors plays a huge role. And of course, the maturity of the fintech that you're looking at is important to take note of. So Christoph's speaking about earlier stage fintechs where the product is maybe still needs to be proven. And so the investor needs to take a long-term view, looking at, sure, a lot of capital needs to be deployed early on before you're necessarily going to see revenues. And so the investor needs to look forward in how will product market fit be established? What is the potential in the market for this product? And so there is, that's where the risk appetite comes in, and certainly a lot of education in the South African market is required there for taking on more of the risk Then for a business that's further along in the growth phase, which is where Entersekt is at the moment, we have a huge focus on cash flow. We are constantly investing in our product, as well as our contracts and revenue lines. So at that point, the investor wants to be looking at, yes, cash flow, but that's not necessarily the be-all and end-all, and that's obviously why capital is needed, why the fundraising process is happening. And so the investor needs to look at things like recurring revenue. So how much of the revenue is certain? Things like how stable are margins? And not necessarily only looking at your EBITDA or your revenue and applying a multiple. It's looking at much more than that. And then looking as well, using Entersekt as an example, we have a very established South African customer base where the business is much more mature, the product market fit is established, and there's growth within the market, but it's an established business. And so that can be valued, and then the growth portion can be valued, in our growth markets. And then you're looking at things like what changes need to be made to the product in order to be appropriate for a different market, say in Europe or in the US. So what investment is required for that? And then what is the revenue potential? And you can imagine, in South Africa, we've got our limited few banks. Our customers are banks specifically. But in markets like the US, you've got thousands of different banks. How do we make sure our product is appropriate for those banks? How do we approach those banks? As I mentioned, partnerships earlier, and then establishing your direct channels from there. But for the investor to look at the market potential in those growth markets, and not just looking at what is the IP worth or what's the EBITDA multiple that we're going to apply. Safiyya, yeah, you look like you're itching to say something.
Sorry, I thought that I probably just wanted to at this point say that this is exactly where I think we are not, at least for South African businesses, potentially taking advantage of what we have in our policies. And I'm talking about BEE specifically. Say the ICT sector requires 2% of net, 1% of net profit after tax of a company and operating in the ICT sector to be deployed for enterprise development in the ICT sector. Now, I don't think that enough innovation and thought, my experience, has been given to the deployment of that capital as risk capital for exactly these reasons. How do you then partner that with supplier development so that the company that you are deploying capital to also becomes a supplier so that there are customers suddenly and revenue that flows into the company? On the financial services side, there's empowerment financing, huge amounts that are required to be deployed by the likes of banks and insurance companies that I don't think enough thought has been given to. As an example, there's also enterprise development and requirements there. There's alternatives to black ownership for banks and so forth in relation to empowerment financing, particularly the multinationals, that could also be looked at. All I'm saying is, and this is what I would like to leave everyone with, that we haven't thought about this from a South African perspective innovatively enough. I think we've got the policies in place, but we haven't thought about how do we apply that innovatively so that it's deployed to achieve the purpose that those pieces of legislation was meant to achieve.
Thank you very much. I think I'm going to allow one more question. I think we need to wrap up. Yes.
Just one final question. Out of interest, given what happened on Friday with the Silicon Valley Bank collapsing, what do you think the ripple effect would be for Africa eventually?
First of all, some of the ripple effect, because obviously the UK is still many African countries' main trading partner. So I think that HSBC and Bank of England stepping in has stopped some of the ripple effect that we will see. But I also think that Silicon Valley Bank hearing its name, I think deployed a lot of at-risk capital because that was why they were set up, is to provide early stage finance and so on. I think hopefully the U.S. regulators will maybe apply some more stringent prudential requirements. Maybe certain categories of banks, because in the U.S. they have all these different categories of banks. They might increase some of the liquidity ratios that some of those, let's call it at-risk lenders. If I can call lending is at risk, but who goes for that sector are maybe better have more liquid capital available.
Can I add that just from an operational perspective? Obviously, African businesses would be exposed to that kind of thing where your customers are maybe based in the US or in Europe or something like that, and not having access to the capital could be a huge, could have a huge negative impact on African or South African businesses where, earning in dollars, maybe that's one of your biggest customers, whether it's the biggest customer or just because of exchange rates. So I think it is a huge risk for us because a lot of fintechs need to scale internationally in order to be successful. Mm. That kind of thing leaves us very open to cash flow problems of our own because of the reliance on those banks. And so, you know, to Christoph's point, it needs to be addressed by the regulators to make sure that there isn't that contagion effect so that other customers of ours also can't access their funds in order to pay, you know, to pay us.
Thank you very much. And the last thing I just want to add to that is pre-financial crisis, packaging consumer credit card debt with other AAA-rated assets was the name of the game. And I think this is kind of what Lindsay is also alluding to, is that those things do have a ripple effect on, you know, especially in, like, developing markets. But there's still a hell of a lot of opportunity. And I think, you know, I definitely, like, I'm quite positive about this sector in South Africa. I'm quite excited about what's going to happen over the next few years in financial services, you know, and we've got a vibrant technology space. And I think we should kind of, you know, be less critical on ourselves and look around us. And, you know, like, for your bigger players to support, like, local talent, local technology, because of there are amazing things around, and you know I'm often amazed when I go and see a new client, and one of the first things they do is they show us their product, and you go, wow, like, you know, this was built in, you know, in Stellenbosch, or it was built here at Wits University, you know, in a boarding house or something like that. So definitely, you know, positive. And I thank you all. Thank you to each of the panel members. And thank you for joining us. I think there's some coffee and refreshments outside. And we will still be around. So if you haven't asked your question, you're welcome to do so outside. Thank you.